Well, let's go on. I, by the way, observe that the microphone still hasn't fell down. So. Let's see. So up to now, remember we are speaking about computation of invariant objects, and we have covered numerical techniques. I would like to go to semi-analytical techniques, and I had planned to speak about the least Poincaré method, which is very known, and another strategy that is somehow more recent, what is called the parametrization method for fixed points of flows. With respect to the Listed Poincaré method, it consists on taking listed series, which are Fourier series in which the frequencies, so these are Fourier series for the trajectories, in which the frequencies also depend on the amplitudes. Here the amplitudes would be alpha and beta, which will be related, say, to a planar amplitude and a vertical amplitude. And then the frequencies are expanded also in those amplitudes. This is necessary because when you start to ask for this kind of expansion to verify the differential equation order by order in alpha and beta, you get some secular terms that you cannot kill if you do not assume that the frequencies vary with the amplitudes, which is actually true. I mean, it's given by the Lyapunov centers theorem for the planar and Lyapunov families, for instance. So you could do this kind of expansions for the planar families, the vertical, or the family of Riesz-Schütter-Ai. And they are really useful because a very good thing about them is that they provide you directly the trajectories in terms of parameters. So if you want to implement any kind of targeting algorithm in order to get to a specific point of torus or whatever, is to do. You have a, well, easy. Straightforward to do. You have an explicit expression, and this you can differentiate with respect to whatever you want, with respect to alpha, with respect to beta, with respect to one of the phase, and it's very, well, it's very useful. I have here some slides that do not explain the least Poincaré method in its generality, but in a simple example, just take a linear harmonic oscillation with a nonlinear part that has coefficients equal to one, all of them, and this is very, it's very detailed. You can follow it if you want and check, do all the calculations on the side, and you will see how this thing about not being able to kill secular terms if you do not allow the frequency to vary happens. So let me just skip this because the time is really, really limited. And you have this to check if you want. There is an exercise at the end that provides hints on how to generalize to the general algorithm in order to get those expansions that are for the residential body problem in the center manifold. And let me go to the parametrization method. So, well, something you have to watch with any semi-analytical method is that the expansions you get are always non-convergent. They cannot be. Well, at least for the Liszt Poincaré, of course they cannot be, because this kind of expansion assumes you have two parametric continuous family of Torre, and this is not true. There are gaps, so the expansions cannot converge. The parametrization method for fixed points of flows, of which I want to speak now, is an alternative semi-analytical method in order to get an expansion, not of the trajectories, which is really, really nice, but of the center manifold itself. So let's see how it goes. Well, this is actually a different way of doing, you can also get an expansion of the center manifold by performing canonical transformations on the Hamiltonian in order to isolate the directions that correspond to the hyperbolic part, and then put them equal to zero, and you get the Hamiltonian reduced to the center manifold. The results you get are exactly the same. I can send you to references on that if you want to check it. This is just another way to obtain the same thing. But it's a fact, is somehow more general, less involved in what it respects to change of coordinates. There will only be one change of coordinate that will be linear, and that's it. And also is very flexible. Does not allow you to compute only the center manifold, but any manifold you want. So let's formulate it. So assume we have a fixed point of a flow, and we want to find a manifold tangent to some eigendirections of this point, to any of them. Doesn't matter which ones. So what we do? We linearize the system, and this is the only change of variables we need to do. So we do a change of variables in order to put the fixed point at the origin. And also we order the eigenvalues so that the manifold we want to compute is tangent to the first d directions. So I mean, you can do any set of eigenvalues just by putting them first of the list. Right? It's a question of the change of variables. So just for simplicity, assume that we are given the diagonalized system. So we have a system of differential equations in which zero is a fixed point, and the differential at the fixed points is diagonal. But it's non-linear, I mean, just the linear part is diagonal, but then we have other line. Okay? So we look for two things. One, a parameterization of the invariant manifold, okay? Which is, one thing we don't will of this is we do not worry about realifying. So we look for expansions as complex. In this?
What happens if you have double
eigenvalue?
Sorry? If you have double
eigenvalue? Ah, yeah, well, then the homological equations I will write to are not so easy. You need to rewrite everything, but you can deal with this. We will just end up with a homological equation which is not the number. But, so it's not a problem, it's complicated things. But okay, many, many problems can be covered by this and the relation points for sure. So, assume the linear part is diagonal. So we look for a parametrization of the manifold, and for the vector field reduced to parameter space. So this is so we look for an f such that s dot equal f of s on s are the parameters. So we have d parameters because the manifold we look for is d dimensional. So we assume that these are the differential equations of the manifold. If you impose this equation, you get to this equation here that is called the invariant equation. You can do it analytically, but there is a very clear geometrical argument. So say, if I have a curve in a parameter space that is converted to a curve on the manifold by the parameterization, for this to be true, I need that the vector field reduce that the vector field in parameter space when pushed back, I never remember how this is said, but when translated to the manifold by the differential of the parameterization needs to coincide with the original vector field at the point of the manifold. So this is the argument. In order to compute them, we expand them in power series, so let's denote by a subindex k the terms of order k of the Taylor series, both in the parameterization and in the reduced vector field. So each component of those are vectors. Each component is a homogeneous polynomial of the k. And then what we want to do is to solve the equation, the invariance equation, which is here, is the same one as here, order by order. So imposing this order by order gives rise to a cohomology equation that we need to solve. And the thing is that it could be diagonal, as you will see in a moment. I need some more notation. Let's use superindexes for the coordinates of the components of the vectors of homogeneous polynomials, both for the parameterization and for the reduced vector field. And then, we need to solve the cohomology equation. We start with first order, which is kind of natural. I mean, if you want the manifold to be tangent to the first directions, you take the linear terms like this. And then the behavior is the linear behavior, so each coordinate is multiplied by the corresponding eigenvalue. So I erased it, this. And then let's go for to order k. Well, you have to take the patience of expanding, of Taylor expanding the things in the correct way in order to be able to put to the right hand side of the equation. So I mean, what I am doing is ask for this equality at order k, right? When you do that and expand by Taylor in the needed way, you can put everything that is known to the right, and what you get is this. And in this expression, this is a product, this is a matrix vector product of okay, homogeneous polynomials, but homogeneous polynomials can be differentiated with no problems, so this is done without problems. You go a general equation, but it's just arithmetic operations. The hard thing to do is this one. That means, take the parameterization you have compute up to order k minus 1, plug it in the vector field, and get the Taylor and get the order k terms of this Taylor expansion. This is the hard thing to do. And in order to do this fast, and so things always go fast, you need to tailor the algebraic manipulator in order to do this in a really fast way. And I will comment in a moment how to do this. But let's just keep this on hold and go on solving the cohomology equation. Then, this is the right-hand side. And in the left-hand side, what you get is this thing here. Well, this has been reduced to the lower monomial. So you equate everything and then you equate the coefficient of each monomial. This m stands for the monomial. This is the vector of indexes. And this m is m1, so this is m1 md. So that means the monomial is s1 to the power of m1, to s2 to the power of m2, up to sd to the power of md. So okay, this is a monomial. At the level of monomials, you have those expressions here, which are different for the components from 1 to d, remember d is the dimension of the manifold, than from the components from d plus 1 to n. So the most important thing is to solve the components from d plus 1 to n. In order to do that, you need to isolate the term of the parameterization. So you have this factor here. In order to solve for the manifold, you need that this factor is not zero. Well, you will recognize as some of the things that appear when you compute normal forms. This is a linear combination of the first d eigenvalues, okay, minus another of the eigenvalues of the d plus 1 to n. We say that this is different. If this is zero, there is a cross resonance. So if there is no cross resonances, this is different from zero, and then you can compute the manifold. This is not a strange restriction and doesn't give any problems at all. If you want to compute, for instance, the stable manifold, you will have the first d eigenvalues will be all of them with negative real part, the remaining one will have positive or zero real part, and this can never be zero because the m's are not always. Right? So, it means it's in the core of what you need in order to compute the manifold. So, it's no problem for all the typical cases. And then, this.
If you have negative things against positive things
if you want to look for the usual stable manifold, center manifold, so doesn't happen. There's no small division. There's no small divisors problems. These divisors are not small. You can bound them. You can give lower bounds. So, this is for the equations from d plus 1 to n, and for the first d, you have a choice, because you have this expression here. You can either take the term of the parameterization equal to 0 and put the term of the reduced vector field equal to the right hand side, or the opposite, you can take the vector field equal to 0 and isolate the term of the parameterization. This gives rise to what we call different styles of parameterization. So, taking the parameterization equal to zero and leaving the responsibility to the reduced vector field is what we call the graph style. And this is because in this way, what you get is that the parameterization, the components from 1 to d of the parameterization have only linear terms, or these ones. So is the identity, and then the manifold is expressed as a graph. So, and then is the simplest parameterization. What you do is to complicate the reduced vector field. You could also take the normal form approach. Try to take the reduced vector field as simple as possible. Okay, so you solve when you can. You solve for the reduced vector field. So that means if there is not an internal resonance, and if there, if the, in the case of a resonance, then you take the reduce the parameterization equal to zero, and the reduce, well, you keep the corresponding term of the reduced vector field, like in a normal form, right? Another style that we found that is very useful is a mixed style, in which you do not do, well, you do a mixed thing. Well, anything different from this could be called a mixed style. A particular one that is of very high interest is to solve in order to have some manifolds that in parameter space are expressed as coordinates equal to zero invariant. For the sake of the argument, to keep the argument easy, well, this is the general argument, but let me argument in terms of one coordinate. If I want to have the S1 equal to zero manifold invariant, what I need to do is that the first components of the reduced vector field, when evaluate at an S point that has S1 equal to zero, to be zero. For this, this will be true for any monomial that has an exponent in S1, different from zero. So I only need to kill the monomials of the reduced vector field that have S, the M1, well, the exponent of S1 equal to zero, that means M1 equal to zero, and this is this condition here. So if you do this, well, this is for S1, but you can do this for a set of S. You can ask for S1 equal to zero, S1 equal to S2 equal to zero to be invariant. Is one equal to is two equal to is three equal to zero invariant, and you can do more of one of them. I mean, you can ask for several kinds of manifolds of this type to be invariant at the same time. And if you do this, what you do is that you get a parameterization that is adapted to the dynamics, and you will see in a moment how this works in the examples. But let me comment on efficiency. So the important thing to hear to, for the computations to be done fast. Is to have a very efficient algebraic manipulator. So you need to optimize on one side the arithmetic operations and on the other side the elementary functions. And you need to be able to compute fast the order k terms of the sine of a Taylor expansion. Right? So for the arithmetic operations, the one that is important to optimize is the product, which is because it's one of the sum is the most difficult one. Actually, division, we will do it as a as an elementary operation. So in here, the representation of the polynomial plays a role. So well, this is actually an implementation that Alex did. In representing the series of polynomials in S variables, I mean, any polynomial in S variables can be represented as a polynomial in the last variable whose coefficients are polynomials in D minus one variables. If you mimic this representation recursively in memory, you can end up with a representation in which to do the product of homogeneous polynomials reduce to do scalar products of vectors of coefficients. And then it goes very fast, you don't need hash tables, and it's really, really fast. Alex has done some tests against software that he has tried, I think, against the software from the Observatory of Paris, that you cannot remember the name. But he has done some tests that I think he has beaten all of them in speed. The other important thing is to be able to do fast the sine of a series or the cosine of a series. That is to compute the composition of an elementary function phi on a series. And this, it turns out, in the spirit of automatic differentiation, can be done very, very efficiently in terms of a concept that is called the radial derivative. And this is also a very idea about this. This is actually the generalization of a concept that you can find in the second volume of the Art of Computer, of the second volume of the Art of Computer Programming by Ivanov, which does this in one dimension. This is the generalization to several dimensions. The thing is that you can define the radial derivative as the product of the radian of a function times the point. This works very well on homogeneous polynomials. It's just to put a k in front. This also satisfies a kind of chain rule. And from this, if you have a differential equation for the function, for phi, then you can solve for you can solve for the coefficients of the composition and get a recurrences. I skip the details. You have some hints on how to do the computation here, and I propose you to revise them. But the thing, just let me remark that if we take, in this case, phi the power to the alpha, for alpha real, any real, the restricted body problem would be minus three halves, because it's the denominator you have in the vector field or the distances to the primaries. Then it turns out that in order to compute the order k terms of the function power to the three halves on a series, you get an expression like this, in which, well, it's actually the same as the one you get when you multiply homogeneous polynomials, because here k minus j plus j is k. So the effort of taking a series and taking the power alpha of a series is the same as doing the product with another series, which is the least you can expect, and it's really, really fast, and what I found is really, really surprising. So, of course, this is much faster than what you do with any generic purpose algebraic manipulator, in which, in order to do that, you take the expansion of f, take the expansion of phi, plug it in, expand and truncate. But this is much faster. And you do not do any kind of algebraic manipulation. It's just, well, it's in the spirit of automatic differentiation. So, in this way you write the algebraic manipulator and you can solve for the right-hand side, well, you can compute the right-hand side of the common logical equation. Then you can compute the manifold up to any order you want. One thing you need to do is to check for the precision of this manifold. There is several ways to do it. Let's just focus on the orbit error. So if you have a solution of the reduced vector field in parameter space, you can take the initial condition to the original space and then iterate the corresponding solution of the original space. So you have S and you have X. You can do this for a time that is adequate for the problem under study. In our case, not very large, because we have the hyperbolic directions that will introduce error here. And then we can compare the conversion of the solution in parameter space to original space to the parameterization with the integration in original space. And this gives an estimation of the error of manifold. And with this, if we have a parameter like the energy in our case to grow away from the fixed point, we can see up to which energy the expansions are good. So let's do this. Well, again, this is the three-body problem. This is a slide we have already seen. I think I didn't say it, but all the computations I am showing you are for the Earth-Moon case, right? So these ones are, and all the previous one are too. Well, this is something that we have already seen, the theoretical justification of all the families that appear. And this is just some data about computing the center manifold of L1 in the restricted three-body problem Earth-Moon. So we order the eigenvalues putting the central part first in order to get the center manifold. And then we take d equal to 4, so it's four-dimensional. Do the linear change in order to take L1 to 0 and diagonalize. Apply the algorithm, we obtain W and F, and then the parameterization, we need to undo the diagonalization change. That would be this one, and this is the parameterization of the manifold. This is some computational times, and I apologize for the Linux people, because there is a Mac here. I have never put a Mac here, but Alec did this, which is a Mac version, so sorry. But, the thing is that you can go up to order 70 in just a little over half an hour, which is quite good. I mean, a series of order 70 in four variables has something like 1 million coefficients, and you need to multiply it by 6 because these are 6 coordinates. So, I mean, it's a lot. So this is the same kind of Poincaré sections I showed you before, computed numerically, but these are computed semi-analytically. So here, this is parameter space. Well, we do the usual thing. The center manifold is four-dimensional. When we restrict to an energy, it's three-dimensional. And when we take a Poincaré section, that we take S4 equal to 0, then it's two-dimensional, and then we can plot. And then this is S1, S2. And this is in parameter space, this is what it looks in configuration space, here is the moon. And you see this as L1 is more the sun here. And as we increase the energy, we get only this azure toroid, then quasi halo toroid, that get bigger and get bigger. And this is close to the limit in which the expansions have a reasonable precision. I will show graphs of precision later, but well, right now, but not with this example, but with an example in which the parameterization is added to the dynamics. So, if we ask, if we redo the computation, but when solving the cohomological equation, we ask the S3 equal to S4 equal to 0 to be invariant, then as a consequence of this, S1 and S2 describe the planar we have performance. If we, in addition, ask S1 equal to S2 equal to 0 to be invariant, as a consequence of this, S3 and S4 describe the vertical we have performance. And this means that when we do the Poincaré sections, and in here you can think that any point in this Poincaré section corresponds to a point which was S1 and S2 from the plot, S3 computed from the energy, and S4 equal to 0 because it's a Poincaré section. Right? Then necessarily the point corresponding to the vertical level of orbit is the origin. That here it was not, it's a little to the left origin. And this is what is really convenient, for instance, if you want to do error plots, because or if you want to draw this, because if you just shoot from the vertical line, you get nearly everything. And then it's easy to do this kind of ones. Easy to do this kind of plots in which, well, this is the S2 for each energy level. Say, for instance, take this one, minus one for 0.565. Well, S2 is equal to zero, S1 is equal to zero. No, yes. Yes, and S2 goes from a minimum value to a maximum value that depends on the planar level of orbit. Normalize this, assume that this is minus one and this is plus one, and then take one of these points, do the estimation on the orbit, and plot the error. And this is what these graphics are. So you can see that order 10, we have precision up to minus 1.58, or the 20 it improves, or the 30 it improves. Things that not improve very much from order 30 on. So I mean, up to minus 1.565 is okay. And well, this is a typical behavior of the kind of series you get of this kind of center value for the RGB and the domain of, say, good approximation that goes up very sharply. So from here we conclude that, well, we will use the expansions up to order 30. That's it. And the exercise you can try to do is to check some points of these graphs. For this, you can actually use the software. Let me now just do a little advertising. There is a book on the parameterization method that was published yesterday. What I have been talking about is the second chapter of this book, and it's the only one in which I took part. But it treats the parameterization method in a very general way. This is actually a philosophy that can be used to compute invariant manifold of fixed points, but can also be used to prove KM theorems in posterior versions that can be converted into numerical algorithms to find invariant tori. You have several examples here. Well, the numerical algorithms do not cover the tori I have been speaking about, because those ones are elliptic hyperbolic normally. The tori you can find here are either Lagrangian or completely hyperbolic. But I mean, you can find here many KM estimates that are really sharp and it's really interesting. So ask for it in your university libraries and department libraries and make it a bestseller. The thing is that we have published the software of chapters 2 and 4. You can find them here. Well, it's not everything, but there is just enough in order to be able to take an initial condition in parameter space and compute the orbital error so that you can check these graphs. I mean, if you want to play with it, it's an excuse to get familiar with it. So you can try to do it. I'm going to skip this because I am terribly behind of schedule. This is the same for L2. Right? So here, this is in parameter space. This is, you have L2 here because this is x coordinate smaller than mu minus 1. And these are the previous error plots up to order 30, these are the plots of R2, around L2 up to order 30, which are quite similar. You have similar errors for similar energies, which is consistent with the fact that you can find determining connections and so on. So, with this I conclude the part of computation of invariant objects. Remember that we wanted to be able to compute, say, nominal trajectories, but also to be able to connect them. In order to connect them, we need to use stable and unstable manifolds. Let me go fast over how to compute the stable and unstable manifolds of periodic orbits, but actually, and toroid, we'll come in toroid too. But for periodic orbits, it's a consequence of all the formulations we have developed. Okay, periodic orbits are seen as fixed points of the time, of the flow time, the period of the orbit. So computing an invariant manifold of a periodic orbit is like a computing an invariant manifold of a fixed point of a map. So all you need to do is to adapt the formula. So just imagine, assuming there is an initial condition of a t-periodic orbit, parameterize the manifold by rescaling time in order to interface, which is this here. Then assume you have an eigenvalue of the monodromy matrix greater than one for unstable manifolds, more than one for a stable one, and the corresponding eigenvector. Then you can parameterize all the tangent vectors to the manifold by propagating with the differential of the flow, which you compute from the variational equations, just in order to get a two-periodic function correct for the rescaling due to the eigenvalue. So when theta is equal to 2 pi, this is equal to lambda to the minus 1, that cancels the lambda that appears after applying the differential of the flow. Right? So with this you have the periodic orbit as a curve, the tangent vectors to the manifold as a curve of vector space. Take a small displacement, and this is the linear approximation of the invariant manifold. This has an error that is quadratic in the displacement, so you can evaluate this only for a small psi. But if you want to go farther, what you can do is to apply it for a large psi, just integrate backwards. So when integrating backwards for a period, you get a multiplication by lambda minus 1, multiply enough in order to get this second parameter small, then use the previous expression, and this is a mistake, sorry. I will correct those mistakes in the last version. I will. There is here a bar psi is missing. Okay, so you apply this to the linear approximation of the manifold, and then you integrate. And then you can get as far as you want. And you can use this formula in order to target a specific point in the invariant manifold from any point behind, so you can shoot from where the manifolds are close to the small primary, which is there in the SANF case, or whatever you want to know. Let me comment very fast how to do invariant manifolds of Torrell, but to give you the idea. So recall that we didn't find the toroid as two-dimensional toroid, but an invariant curve, but invariant curves of the torus. So they solve the invariance equation. When you evaluate the parameterization of the torus at a phase, evaluate the parameterization of the torus at a phase, and go for the second period of the torus, you get to the parameterization incremented in rho. So the equivalent condition in order to get a tangent bundle would be to evaluate the vector tangent to the manifold at a phase, propagate it through the differential of the flow times t2, and then you want to get the parameterization of the manifold at the phase plus rho, and this is just the change of variable here, but multiply it by the eigenvector. This would be the condition for a vector tangent to the invariant manifold. So you can use this notation for this as an operator and write it in this way. And then what you can do is to discretize this operator in order to get a matrix instead of C, and then look for eigenvalues of this matrix. In order to discretize this, this is not just a graphical representation of what I said, so you take an eigenvector here, propagate it through the differential of the flow, and you get the parameterization of the vector here, but multiply it by the So don't be afraid. This is just, you can revise it if you want to implement it, but you can discretize this operator using the discrete Fourier transform. This is the discrete Fourier transform in complex form, which is the most easy to understand. take the samples and multiply them by exponential trigonometric terms with frequencies that are k over n, k goes from 0 to n minus 1. But if you want to approximate the function from the coefficients of the discrete Fourier transform, you need to write the real and the real cosine and sine of the transforms. The formulas are here, don't worry. Then, if you have if you want to find how the C operator acts, you need to find an arbitrary set of Fourier coefficients, apply the operator, and get the Fourier coefficients corresponding to applying these operators. Then, by using this thing about the discrete Fourier transform, well, the discretized operator would be a matrix. The way to get the columns of a matrix is to evaluate it in the canonical basis. The canonical basis would be the functions that correspond to taking 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1 here. And these functions are sines and cosines. Well, sines and cosines are in some coordinates, because we are working with 6 coordinates. 3 minutes. 3 minutes, okay. Okay. Well, so, believe me, you can get everything from the discrete Fourier transform of the columns of the monodomy of the differential of the flow. And you can just do it and get the same matrix, compute the eigenvalues, take some things into account, but you look for the eigenvalue corresponding to lambda, lambda minus minus 1, and this gives you the manifolds. And then you can globalize the manifold in a way that is very similar to the way of globalizing the manifold for periodic orbits. This is just going step by step, doing the same as in periodic orbits. You can check all the computations, and this is an example of an invariant manifold of a torus, which, well, is more complicated than the one for periodic orbit. You can also do interpolation and do kind of mission design, say, well, trajectory design from interpolated manifolds. You can also do it with the Lister-Poincaré method. You can find this reference in detail, but the Lister-Poincaré methods can give you both the trajectories and the manifolds. And then you can also use the parametrization method, which does not need any modification. You can go for the center stable manifold by using these eigenvalues, for the center unstable by using these eigenvalues. And the program is exactly the same. And if you want to adapt the parametrization to the dynamics, you can ask for all these manifolds of the form SI equal to 0 to be invariant in this way. S1 and S2 scale the planar diagonal orbits, S3 and S4 scale the vertical diagonal orbits, the first four coordinates describe all the torre, and then S5 gives stable manifolds, and S6 gives unstable manifolds of everything. And it's exactly the same problem, no modification at all, just put D equal to 6. And well, there are some examples of computation of these manifolds, their own estimates. I have to go over. The thing is that using S5 and X6, you can get what locally are called the transit and non-transit trajectories. Here are some examples. And then just let me go very quickly on how to connect trajectories. They are connected, well, what theoretically are called homoclinic and heteroclinic connections. A homoclinic connection is a connection from one object to itself, heteroclinic from an object to a different one. In order to get this kind of connected trajectories, you need to match manifolds. So in order to get here's all the formulation. In order to get a single trajectory, you just consider Poincaré sections and match them. So you have, for instance, if you want to get an heteroclinic of a Lyapunov orbit, you get a stable manifold to the Poincaré section, get a curve. Unstable manifold get to the Poincaré section, get a curve. Intersection of those two give homoclinic connections that you can get. For torii is more complicated because well, the intersections with the manifold are not curves, are tubes, but you can use clouds of points and find them. And then you can compute individual connections in this way. Something, if you want to get families, something you can do is to do continuation on them. And well, I don't have time, but you can put everything into the equations, the conditions for periodic orbit, the condition for eigenvector of the monodomy matrix and stable part, eigenvector of the monodomy matrix, stable part, and then matching, then time of flight to the Poincaré section in which you want to match the manifolds, and the actual matching of the manifolds. You can do continuation on the system, and then continue to homoclinic connections. These are some we computed several years ago that well, I put some here because just because they are nice. There's some fish-like and in here you go from fish to jellyfish, and I wouldn't know how to describe that. And well, the excuse to do that was to compute cyclic trajectories. You can get periodic orbits that show homoclinic connections, and here you have some examples. And then a natural question would be, can you do this with toroid? Yes, you can do it with toroid too. You can just put everything on the equations. Let me go just to the final. So you can look for an invariant toro, a departing invariant torus, an arrival invariant torus, put the condition for invariant torus, the condition for invariant manifolds, time of flight to the section, the same for the arrival torus, and then the matching conditions. And then you can, from here, you can compute an individual connection and do continuation of it. To compute individual connections, you need the databases of toroid and manifolds in order to get an initial guess, and then you can refine it and do continuation, and in this way you get families, a family of heterocleitic connections. And this is work in progress. We are in this way we get just individual families, but we are working on how to classify all of them, so there is more work needed. And this is actually the last slide. So here you have some references, but you can download the slides and look at everything. So that's my lecture. Hope you find it useful, interesting or useful perhaps in the future. And that's it. Thank you.